We are back. Thank you. Thank you, everyone who gave this morning, partnered with God in building the kingdom of God here in this area, in this country, and on this earth. And thank you for those who join later and tune in to our service. And I just we're going to go into God's word, and I just pray that God's word will speak to you this morning, will encourage you, and will challenge you. Amen. Amen. Now, for the last 3 weeks, we talked about three important things that that we as a church we will value, we'll give more attention, we'll prioritize more starting with September. And I call this mini series of sermons, the three sermons, called Connection. Starting from September, we're going to value these three topics, these three important things. And I looked at the definition online for the connection, and I came across and explained that there are three different definitions, three different ways how connection is explained. And I took all these three and related to our three topics. And it says that is the state of being related to someone and something else, a relationship in which a person is linked or associated with something else. And a connection is a relationship between two things, people or groups. So how do we relate to God? Through worship. How do we have a relationship with God? Through prayer. And how do we have a connection? Through connecting with one another. So the last 3 weeks spoke about worship, prayer, and today we're going to speak about connection. A connection is a relationship between two things, people or groups. And today I want to focus on Jesus' words that speaks on relationships, and specifically the relationship with the small groups. Jesus poured out his life into 12 disciples, and he made a big difference in the world through these 12 disciples. Big gatherings are very important, but the real transformation, the real life change, it takes place in a small group. And a lot of Jesus' teaching that he gave, the crowds didn't understand what he was talking about. So kind of public ministry wasn't that probably that effective, because after he said the parable or a story and nobody understood what on earth he's talking about, Jesus brought his disciples into a small group on the side and explained to them the parables. So let me take you to Jesus' last week of his life, because half of the Gospel of John is about the last week of Jesus. 5 chapters on the last night of Jesus. So Jesus gave his final words to the disciples just before he went to the cross. And we know that in John chapter 13, John chapter 14, John chapter 15 and 16 and 17 all happened in that week. And these 5 chapters, Jesus talks about two things. He talks about the person of the Holy Spirit, and he says, I'm going to leave, and after I leave, I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit, and you need to get closer to him. And the second thing he talks about is relationships. John chapter 13 says like this, in verse 1 says like this. Before the Passover celebration, Jesus knew that his hour had come to leave this world and return to his Father. He had loved the disciples during his ministry on earth, and now he loved them to the very end. It was time for supper, and the devil had already prompted Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. And Jesus knew that the Father had given him authority over everything, and that he had come from God and would return to God. So he got up from the table, took off his robe, wrapped a towel around his waist, and poured water into a basin. Then he began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with a towel he had around him. When Jesus came to Simon Peter, Peter said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? And Jesus replied, you don't understand now what I'm doing, but someday you will. No, Peter protested, you'll never ever wash my feet. And Jesus replied, unless I wash you, you won't belong to me. Now, let's stop here for the moment. We're going to continue further later on. But now, probably this story is not so much fuss in our world today, because it's kind of, you know, a symbol. But in those days, it wasn't that cool. It was very, very important. In those days, the foot washing was going to the lowest of lower as a servant. And because you had to go down on your knees and to see what is between your toes. There are unspeakable things right between your toes, right, people? And here Jesus is getting that close to disciples, and the disciples they get freaked out, because in verse six, he came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" In other words, "Lord, you know what? I enjoyed all these 3 years together with you, but I don't think I'm ready to go that far with you. That's awkward. That's uncomfortable." And watch what Jesus says in verse 7. Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I'm doing, but later you will understand." And most people do not realize how important it is to have few people in your life that you know, that they know what's between your toes. And I said this metaphorically. But there's a modern day application of the foot washing. And this is it, that somebody needs to have someone close into your life that you show the most personal and the most dirtiest area in your life. I don't show it to everybody, but I let you see it. Maybe you don't realize now how important it is, but you'll realize later. And in verse 8, says, "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Watch what Jesus says. Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." Unless you let me that close into your life, we got no partnership here. We got no relationship here. You have no part with me, Peter. You can come in here and say amen and praise the Lord. That's fine here, but it just can't be everywhere. You need to have people where you let someone to know what's between your toes. You need to when you go beyond the awkwardness and the mask and the veil and say, "I let you see." Well, you may ask, why? Why on earth I want to have that? Why do I need this kind of relationship? And here's what's important. Because relationship will give you a couple of things. I did a Bible study for you this morning, chapter 13, John chapter 13, John chapter 14, 15, 16, and 17. And all these chapters have a relationship message. So let's walk through these five chapters and show you why you need someone that close to you. Here's the first one. Relationships will allow you to serve one another. Yes, we ask you to be part of Connection Church and serving here at this church. But you need also to be served. God forbid you go through a situation in life and no one even knows what's going inside of you. Everyone needs to serve, but also to be served from time to time. And Jesus says, I need you to be attentive to each other, serving each other's needs. And in John chapter 13, verse 12 says like this, when he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done to you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now, that is you, Lord. That I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you." And in 1 Peter chapter 4 verse 10 says, "God has given each of you a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them well." To what? To serve one another. Everyone in this church, everyone in this room, everyone who's watching has a gift that someone else needs it. Someone else needs you. I need you. They need you for what you are good at. Amen, everybody? So let's go for the next chapter, next point, to see the power of relationships. Relationships will encourage one another. The word encourage literally means to lift the spirit up. You know, the disciples were fired up about the Last Supper. They weren't fired up about the Last Supper because they were discouraged. Because Jesus kept talking about dying. And they were depressed and they were discouraged. And Jesus says in John chapter 14, don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. You know what the next verse is talking about? Heaven. He starts encouraging them about eternal life. My Father's room. You will be with me forever. By the way, if you want to encourage someone, don't promise them a better life. Encourage them that one day, when this life is over, we will be with Jesus. Always encourage them with heaven. When you are discouraged, you are not very smart in that moment. And you'll make bad decisions and maybe do great crazy things. Because your emotions will play tricks with your mind. It happened to me. I had moments like that. Discouragement in our life when I almost gave up. Almost quit. I was discouraged. But then Hebrews chapter 3 verse 13 says, but encourage one another daily as long as it's called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. You need it daily, because if you don't, you get hardened by discouragement or sin's deceitfulness. Encourage one another. Relationship is about encouraging one another. Connection, small groups, it's about encouraging one another. And here's the third one. Chapter 15. Produce with one another. You know that 1 + 1 = 2. When you gather with someone else, when you partner with someone else, when you are in a relationship with someone else, you will accomplish much more. We are better together. We give together. We serve together. We can do so much more together than we can do it on our own. And in John chapter 15 verse 4 says like this, remain in me and I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me, if you are connected with me, if you have a relationship with me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. I am the vine, you are all the branches that needs to be connected. Because by yourself, you will produce nothing. Get into a group. Get connected. So you can produce more. Deuteronomy chapter 32 verse 30 says, one man will chase 1,000. Two put 10,000 to flight. And here's the fourth. Next chapter 16, it says, relationship is about protecting one another. Connection groups, small groups, it's about protecting one another. John 16, the same night, watch what it says in verse 1. All this I have told you so that you will not, what? Fall away. Fall away in Greek, it is scandalizo. It means scandal. He says, I've been telling you this stuff so there won't be any scandals in your life. The word literally means a trap in your path that you cannot see. You have a snare in your path right now that you cannot see. Now, with your own eyes, you might catch it, but with extra eyes, you will definitely see it. And Jesus says, if you stay together, you can protect one another from these traps. Another translation says, these things I have spoken to you that you may not be scandalized. I always have the church leaders behind me to protect me from going into trap. You need the group. You need a connection group, a small group, someone who you know what's going into your life, what you watch, what you say, how you behave when nobody else is there. Ecclesiastes chapter 4 verse 9 says, two people are better off than one, for they can help each other succeed. If one person falls away, the other can reach out and help. But someone who falls alone is in a real trouble. And verse 11 in the message says, two in a bed warm each other. Alone, you shiver all night. By yourself, you are unprotective. With a friend, you can face the worst. By yourself, you are unprotected. In relationship, in a connection group, in a small group, you are protected. You protect one another. And the last principles on partnership, on relationship that Jesus gives is in John 17. And it says, John 17, relationship is about pray for one another. Connection groups, small groups, it's about pray for one another. John 17 verse 1 says, after Jesus said this, he looked towards heaven and prayed. And watch what he prayed. Many don't see this and it will shock you. In verse 9, I pray for them. I'm not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. I pray for them, not for the world. I'm going to pray for Thomas. I'm going to pray for Matthew. I'm going to pray for James. I'm going to pray for Peter. And that's about the relationship, the connection, the small groups. I'm praying for you. I'm praying for the leaders. The leaders are praying for you. I'm praying for the elders. And the elders have their own groups. I'm praying for them. And everybody for their own group and for their own group. And at the end of the day, everybody gets prayed for. I can guarantee you that your name goes to God every day if you get into a group. If you get into a connection group. If you get into a partnership, into a relationship. Relationships. First thing you should do when you get into a small group is exchange phone numbers and start praying for each other. Amen, everybody. Look what James chapter 5 verse 16 says. Confess your sin to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The earnest prayer of the righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. And this is my message in one sentence. We is always better than me. We is always better than me. I know maybe it's bad English, but it's good preaching. Amen, everybody? Amen. Connection groups that we have in our church are part of our life, our church life. This connection group that we have weekly, it's not another event that you need to attend to. This is our part of a church life. And if you're not part of any group, you miss so much more. And honestly, I don't understand why are you not part of any connection groups. I mean, don't you want to serve and to be served? Don't you want to be encouraged? Don't you want to be able to produce more fruit? Don't you want to be cared for and protected for? Don't you want to be prayed for? That's what you get if you are connected in a relationship in our connection groups. In September, that is what we're going to focus on. Worship, prayer, and connection group. Because the real life happens in these groups. The growth happens in these groups. The care happens in these groups. Worship corporately, prayer together, prayer in groups, individual prayers, prayer as a church, different groups of prayers, and connection groups. Church, you have 2 weeks before we start in September. 2 weeks time to think about, to decide, why not choose to be part of any group starting with September. Amen? Amen. We'll have ways how you can do it. You can always come to me, one of the leaders of the church. But we'll have ways and put on a website different forms and ways so you can actually sign up and get connected in all the groups. Because that will be our priority starting with September for each one of us to be connected in connection groups. Amen? Amen. I want you to close your eyes and bow down your heads, and because I want to pray for you. I want to pray that you will make the right decision this morning. Starting with September, to say, Lord, I want to be part of that. So I want to pray for you right now. Father, I pray that you will give the church confidence to get into that intimate place, down the toes, down to the secret places, dirty places. And Lord, I pray for everyone to have a place to serve, to get encouraged so we can produce together much fruit and protect each other and pray for each other. Because the power for these gatherings on Sundays comes when we are in the small groups. When we are part of a group and be connected, we can see so much more on Sunday gatherings. So Lord, I pray for each one person, Lord, to make the right decision, Lord, to be part of a small group. Relationship are formed in a small group, Lord, and I pray for them. They will form relationships in the small groups. Lives are changed in a small group. And I just pray, Lord, that they will get part of these small groups. So their faith can be built through these small groups. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 I just want to end up to this morning service with the song, the blessing song. So the worship team will come up and will bless you with a blessing song. So thank you everyone for watching. Thank you for being online with us in the last 2 weeks, Lord. And we, by God's grace, next Sunday we'll be again in person here. And may God bless you. Be safe and be blessed in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you.